what have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end, and you could have it all. My empire of dirt, I will let you down. I will make you hurt.
Morning, church. How are we doing? Good morning, Southwest Campus. Good morning, Building D. Let's continue to worship. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Judges chapter 13. Judges chapter 13. We've been in a series on Judges. I thought about wearing a long-haired wig today, but I couldn't find one. But we're going to talk about Samson today. I already have his arms. I just need the hair. Just kidding. Samson today. Judges 13. Would you pursue Jesus if you found out that heaven and hell were not real places? Is the life with Jesus compared to the life without Jesus a high enough difference of quality so that whether heaven or hell exists or not, you would still pursue Jesus and be intimate with him? Because if all it is the afterlife, then it really doesn't give a lot of joy into the present life if it's not affected by the truth of Jesus. Samson is one of those characters in my Bible. By the way, if I say Jephthah before a few weeks ago, you may not have known much about him, or Abimelech, or Ehud. But when I say Samson, things kind of go through your head. We think Delilah. We think strong. But when we look at this character, I mean, he covers four chapters of Judges. He is 20% of this book. There is more written about this character than pretty much any other character in your Old Testament except David and Abraham, maybe Joseph. This guy's life is a flip to all the other judges. All the other judges, if they become weak, they become strong. When Samson is strong, he is weak. This is a guy, I mean, he's Rambo. He's a one-man wrecking crew. You never see him build team. You never see him with close friends. You never see him being held accountable. He just does whatever he wants to do. He is a brute. He's a bully. He was also separated from his mother's womb by a visit from Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, himself. His birth was prophesied, and he was born to a woman who was barren, and he was set apart by a special vow that he would be holy his entire life. This kid should be one of the greatest heroes in the Bible. His name in Hebrew actually means son, S-U-N, son. That this would dawn a new day onto Israel's history. And yet we name our dog Samson and not our sons. Why? This guy should have turned the world upside down for the glory of Christ. But instead we learn from Samson from a bad example. Some of the things we learn from Samson is, what does it mean to be in the world, but not of the world, to be separated from the world, but yet not be disconnected from people in this world? Let me share a couple of verses from the New Testament before we get to Samson. This is what it says in 1 John chapter 2. It says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, the pride in possessions, is not from the Father, but is from the world. How do you live in the world without loving the world and yet still be loving while you live in it? James chapter 4 says it this way, and he starts off a little stronger. He says, you adulterous people. He says, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. He says, when you try to live in the world and become like everyone else in the world and love the same things that everyone else in the world loves, that you're really becoming adulterous toward the Lord. You can't be obedient to the Lord and also do what the world tells you to do. You're going to be unfaithful to one side or the other. Now let's get to Samson. Here's a man that should have done this well, and he doesn't. Chapter 13, Judges, verse 1. And the people of Israel, what's the word? Again, this is the seventh time, again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. So the Lord gave them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. Now the Philistines are not Canaanites. They're a seafaring people that really abide in about five major cities along the Mediterranean. What makes the Philistines different from everyone else is they were the first ones to learn to smelt and use iron. So they became a very strong military people. They also were a people that dominated Israel, not just militaristically, but more importantly, and maybe more sadly, they did it culturally. They started to intermarry with Israel, and Israel started to adopt the Philistine way of doing things. They did it slowly, they did it over time, and before you knew it, you're thinking more like a Philistine than an Israelite. Does this sound familiar at all? And so these Philistines were very smart in the way they did it, that the popular culture becomes the norm. And it says that the Lord gave them over to the Philistines. Now, everywhere else in Judges at this point, it says, and Israel cried out to the Lord, and the Lord heard their cry, and he brought a deliverer. But what you don't see here is that. You don't see Israel cry out to the Lord. And here's the sad part. Israel had become more comfortable being Philistine than not being an Israelite. They had been in popular culture so much, they had listened to popular culture so often, that what popular culture had to say connected more to their mind and more to their heart than what they knew to be true of the Word of God. And so they were quite comfortable being Philistine. Matter of fact, you're going to see an army raised up one time in this text, and it's to take out a fellow Israelite, not to fight against the Philistines. Is it possible for someone who says they're a Christian to live in this culture and look more like the world and look more like Christ? You betcha. We would call it the norm in churches, right? And sad to say, the norm with pastors at times. So let's see what happens. Verse 2, there was a certain man of Zorah, of the tribe of the Danites, whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren, had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, behold, you are barren and have not borne children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Now through here, we're going to see that Israel does what was wrong in the eyes of the Lord, which kind of defines sin for you. Sin is not based on what popular culture says it is or isn't. It's based on what the will of the Lord says versus does not. It's what God's word says, not what culture says. And we say this all the time at the Ridge. We want to view culture through the lens of Scripture. We don't reinterpret Scripture through the lens of culture. Okay? And so these Philistines had caused the Israelites to adapt to them. And then it takes you to this couple, and this woman is barren. In the Bible, barrenness is such a horrible thing, just like it is today. And this woman is told by what we are called the angel of the Lord, which we know from biblically speaking, this is Jesus incarnate. This is not Gideon. This is not Michael. He only does this a few times in the Scripture. But Jesus comes in form of the second person of the Trinity to tell this woman she's barren. Now, this woman at this point does not know who she's talking to. And I don't think she had to be told that she was barren. I imagine this woman has shed many tears about this situation. But the angel of the Lord says, you shall conceive and bear a son. If I had one chapter to teach you on parenthood, parenting, it would be Judges 13. In the next few verses, I'm going to show you why. If you want to be a great parent, this couple, I like this couple. They get it. Why does God, through the Scriptures, give sons to barren women so many times? Because a woman who sees her baby as a miracle from the Lord, a gift from the Lord, has no problem giving that child back to the Lord. Because when a woman has a child and she knows that God touched her for this child, which, by the way, is every birth, that this child is a gift from him, and it's not mine, it's not ours, it's God's child, it's not the parents. And we're going to talk about some parenting principles here. And this has nothing to do necessarily with where I'm taking the text, but it's really good stuff. great men are being born in the Bible to women who cannot have children. And this child is different. Look at verse 4. Therefore, be careful and drink no wine or strong drink. That's not because she's a Baptist. Let me explain. And eat nothing unclean. For behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. No razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to save Israel from the hand of the Philistines. And you're thinking, what in the world? What's a Nazarite? Why can't you shave this child's head? And this is going to be a burly, hairy guy when he grows up. What's the deal? A Nazarite, you go back in your Bible to Numbers chapter 6, and a Nazarite was someone who would dedicate themselves for a definite period of time, and they would, the word Nazar in Hebrew means to separate. So when you're a Nazarite, you separate yourself from culture and popular opinion, and you become separated or cut across from or different from for the Lord's sake. And there were three rules to being a Nazarite. You could not shave your head. Number two, you could not drink from the vine. You could not have an alcoholic drink. It was to be an outward sign on your hair and how you take yourself and around people that you were separated, you were different, you were set apart, you were holy. And a Nazarite is very rare in the Bible. We see three men chosen to be Nazarites from birth because, like I said, in number six, it was for a temporary time period, and yet every once in a while they would do it from birth. Samson, Samuel, and then John the Baptist. Those are the three guys in your Bible that were called to be Nazarites from the womb. They were set apart to be holy. The third thing you could never do in your life if you're a Nazarite is you could not touch anything dead. No dead animals, no dead bodies. If you did, you had to run straight to the tabernacle. You'd have to get ceremonially cleansed again so you could worship God and have fellowship with his people again. And the angel of the Lord comes and says, this child is going to be special. This child is going to be different. But here's the principle I want you to get from Judges 13. Spiritual privilege is no guarantee for spiritual success. Just because you're born into a family that goes to church and you hear the Bible taught does not mean that your kids, does not mean that you, children, are going to love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength just because mom and dad do. You've got to pursue God on your own. Your youth pastor can't do it for you. Your parents can't do it for you. Your friends can't do it for you. Your conferences can't do it for you. This is between you and God. And some parents who are great parents have raised kids, and some kids go wrong, and some kids stay with the Lord. And we see it both in the same family. Some hearts jump to God, and some hearts just have to do everything the hard way, right? Some of you are in this room because you did everything the hard way, and it took you around the world and back, and you're like finally saying, where was this my whole life? It was right here. But some of us love to try to make life work on our own. Let's see what happens. This kid is going to be set apart from birth. Then the woman came and told her husband, a man of God came to me, and his appearance was like the appearance of the angel of God. Very awesome. I did not ask him where he was from, and he did not tell me his name. By the way, I'm going to read a lot of text today, so I need you to listen quickly. But he said to me, behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. So then, drink no wine or strong drink, eat nothing unclean, for this child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb to the day of his death. This man of God, this angel of the Lord, this second person of the Trinity says, I want you to be pure in your pregnancy too, because this son is going to be special. Look at verse 8. Then Manoah prayed to the Lord and said, this is what this tells me. This woman is godly and this man is godly. She comes to her husband and says, a man from the Lord came and said, I'm going to have a child. She's barren. What would most dads do or most men do at that opportunity? You're crazy. I don't believe you. There's no sense of that. He just says, I need to go pray too. I want to hear about what's going on. I believe you. Then Manoah prayed to the Lord and said, oh Lord, please let the man of God whom you sent come again to us and teach us what we are to do with the child who will be born. Parents, number one, your kids are not yours, they're the Lord. Number two, your job as a parent is to ask of the Lord what his desire is for your children, not your desire, his desire. So many parents raise their kids trying to make their parents, their kids, what they want their kids to be, where they want their kids to go to school, where how they want their kids to study, how they want their kids to make money. Manoah goes to the Lord and says, I will need to know what you want of this kid. This is your kid. See what happens. Verse 10, so the woman ran quickly, told her husband, behold, the man who came to me the other day has appeared to me again. And Manoah arose and went after his wife and came to the man and said to him, "Are you the man who spoke to this woman?" And he said, "I am." And Manoah said, "Now when your words come true," I love that. When your word, not if, when your words come true, when my barren wife has a child, what is to be the child's manner of life and what is his mission? I love what this dad is doing as far as parenting is concerned. God, how should I raise this, your child? What do you want from your child? It's a parent saying, "God, help me." See what happens. Verse 13. The angel of the Lord said to Manoah, "Of all that I said to the woman, let her be careful. She may not eat of anything that comes from the vine, neither let her drink wine or strong drink or eat any unclean. All that I command her, let her observe." The angel of the Lord does not tell them any more information. Here's what the answer from the angel of the Lord is. When his parents say, "What do you want of this child?" Here's what the angel of the Lord says, "I want him holy. I want him holy." Parents, are you more concerned about your son's curveball or how much his heart beats for Jesus? Are you more interested in how beautiful your daughter is or how kind her heart is to people with the love of Christ? You see, you may have a talented kid that makes a 4.0 and goes to the best college, I won't name any, goes to the best college, and you can brag about them to your friends and tell them, because every time we say something great about a kid, what we're really thinking is, it's my genetics, right? It's me. And your kid can make all the money in the world and take care of you when you're old because they made a bunch of money. But if they're unkind and unloving and they make fun of people and they don't have a reverence for God and they don't care about anybody but themselves, they are going to be a perverted, sad, ornery individual. And all you've done is you reproduce your own heart. Now, if your kids are talented, great. But let me tell you something. The most important thing biblically is your kid is holy. How do they see holiness? Through mom and dad. Don't send them to a Christian school if you're not going to practice the Bible in your own house. Don't send them to our youth group if you just want the youth pastors to show them how to do it and you're not doing it at home. Dads, don't pay for Regents or Veritas or somewhere else if you're not going to love their mama well in front of them. Because this stuff starts at home. And I believe this was a godly couple. This man believed his wife. He goes and says, "I need more information." The angel of the Lord says, "You don't need more information. I want the kid holy." And it starts with you, mama. It starts with you, daddy. By the way, this is Father's Day part 3. Let's see what happens. Verse 15. Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, "Please let us detain you and prepare a young goat for you." Now, the only application I can pull out of verse 15 is that you honor the man who teaches you the word of God. And you feed him. And the angel of the Lord said to Manoah, "If you detain me, I will not eat of your food," because divine beings don't need to eat. "But if you prepare a burnt offering," now wait a minute, burnt offerings are for God alone. "If you prepare a burnt offering, then offer it to the Lord." For Manoah did not know that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to the Lord, angel of the Lord, "What is your name?" You see, if someone comes and claims deity, you need to say, "What's your name?" He says, "What is your name? So that when your words come true, we may honor you." And the angel of the Lord said to him, "Why do you ask my name, seeing it is wonderful?" I love that answer. He says, "My name is so wonderful, it's so big, you can't even understand my ways." It's the same word wonderful is used when Abraham is told that his wife Sarah is going to have a baby, and Sarah's in the back tent laughing. And the angel of the Lord says, "Is anything too wonderful for the Lord?" Same word. "What is your name?" "My name is wonderful." Verse 19, so Manoah took the young goat with the grain offering and offered it on the rock of the Lord to the one who works wonders, and Manoah and his wife were watching. And when the flame went up toward heaven from the altar, the angel of the Lord went up in the flame of the altar. Now Manoah and his wife were watching, and they fell on their faces to the ground. Now, it's a pretty good day when someone says, "Make a burnt offering for me," and then you watch them go back up in the sky. Pretty cool moment. And now they understand who they were talking to. Look at the next verse, verse 21. The angel of the Lord appeared no more to Manoah and his wife. Then Manoah knew that he was the angel of the Lord. And Manoah said to his wife, "We shall surely die, for we have seen God." He's thinking, because he knows his Bible, we're in trouble because no one sees the Lord and lives. He is too holy, too wonderful. We are too sinful. I love how this woman answers her husband, because most of the time husbands are a little slower than the wives. And Manoah said to his wife, "We shall surely die, for we have seen God." But his wife said to him, "If the Lord had meant to kill us, he would not have accepted the burnt offering and the grain offering at our hands, or shown us all these things, or now announced to us such things as these." And the woman bore a son, called his name Samson. And the young man grew, and the Lord blessed him. And the Spirit of the Lord began to stir him. So when you get through chapter 13, what do you think in chapter 14 is going to tell you? He preached revivals, and people came to Christ, and the Philistines all got converted, and everybody's awesome at the end of chapter 14. That's not what's going to happen. I don't know if you read this story ahead, but he is a jacked up dude. Chapter 14, verse 1. Samson went down to Timnah, and at Timnah he saw one of the daughters of the Philistines. Then he came up and told his father and mother, "I saw one of the daughters of the Philistines at Timnah. Now get her for me as my wife." Now wait a minute. This kid grew up with a godly mama, a godly daddy, who prayed, who sought the Lord. And chapter 14 opens up. The Lord's blessed him. The Spirit of God's with him. And he sees a girl. Parents, don't get too arrogant to think that your godly kid is always going to be godly. All it takes is one wrong girl or one wrong guy to sidetrack them for a long time, if not for life. You stay on your knees as a parent. Literally what it says here in the Hebrew, he says, "Now get her for me as my wife." It literally says, "Get her. She looks good." You're going to start to see that Samson is a lot more concerned about his lust than his God. Verse 3, "But his father and mother said to him, 'Is there not a woman among the daughters of your relatives or among all your people or all the girls at Austin Ridge Bible Church? You must go and take a wife from the uncircumcised Philistines.' But Samson said to her, his father, 'Get her for me, for she is right in my eyes.'" Judges ends by saying, "And every man did what was right in his own eyes." Get her for me, she looks good. Now we start to see in Samson's life at a young age this fatal flaw that he is impulsive and he is unteachable. I don't care what my parents tell me. I don't care what my friends tell me. I don't care what my pastor tells me. I don't care what the word tells me. I'm going to do what my flesh tells me to do because I'm in charge. And this guy should have been glorious for the gospel. Verse 4, "His father and mother did not know that it was from the Lord, for he was seeking opportunity against the Philistines. At that time, the Philistines ruled over Israel." Now, what does that verse mean? It means this, that God can work in your weaknesses and your strengths, in your spiritual moments and your non-spiritual moments. And what his parents didn't realize is that this was how God was going to use their son, Samson, although Samson had every opportunity along the way to repent and do it God's way. That even when someone is stiff-necked and bows up against God, God's still sovereign. And in this man's strength, he's actually become weak, and God's going to do whatever he wants to do. Verse 5, "Then Samson went down his father and his mother to Timnah, and they came to the vineyards of Timnah, and behold, a young lion came toward him roaring." That's happened to me a few times. "Then the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon him, and although he had nothing in his hand, he tore the lion in pieces as one tears a young goat. But he did not tell his father or his mother what he had done." Now, what verse 7 should say is, because he's a Nazarite and he had now touched a dead animal, he ran straight back to the tabernacle to get ceremonially clean so that he could go on his way and continue to do the will of God. That's not what it says. Look at the next verse. "Then he went down and talked with the woman, because she was right in his eyes. She looked good." This man's lust is more important to him than the will of God. And the problem is God at some point in his life is going to say, "Fine, if lust is your God, if lust is your idol, I'll give you over to your lust. And I'll let you do whatever your flesh tells you to do." Guess what you're going to think about all the time? Women. Now, he has this party that he throws over the next several verses. And he comes up with a riddle. Look with me in verse 14. "And he said to them, 'Out of the eater came something to eat. Out of the strong came something sweet.'" When Samson comes back by the lion again, the carcass is there, but some bees had come in, made a home in the carcass, and they were making honey in the lion carcass. Samson, again, a Nazarite, bends down and pulls some of the honey up, and now because his little pet sin is not just a personal inside job, now it's become an outside job, he's walking down the road eating honey out of a dead carcass, a Nazarite. He's got his long hair. So he goes to church, he looks right, everybody thinks he's solid, everybody thinks he's spiritual, he's in a small group, he serves on the team, he loves, he gives, he tithes, but he's just licking that honey in public because he doesn't care what people think anymore. The internal sin has now become external. And so he gives this riddle, and we know the answer to the riddle, but he makes a bet with these guys. He says, all right, if you get my riddle right in 3 days, I'll give you 30 sets of clothes. Now, to us, that's kind of a weird present. But clothing was a huge deal, very expensive. And if you don't get the riddle right, you give me 30 sets of clothing. Well, what these men do, look at verse 15. And on the fourth day, they said to Samson's wife, they couldn't figure it out. They go to his wife, entice your husband to tell us what the riddle is, lest we burn you in your father's house with fire. Hello. Have you invited us here to impoverish us? And Samson's wife wept over him. You're going to see this man does not care much about the holiness of God, but he always gives to the tears of a woman. You only hate me. You do not love me. You have put a riddle to my people, and you have not told me what it is. And he said to her, behold, I have not told my father nor my mother, and shall I tell you? She wept before him the 7 days that their feast lasted. And on the seventh day, he told her because she pressed him hard. See, also nagged him to death. Then she told the riddle to her people, and the men of the city said to him on the seventh day before the sun went down, what is sweeter than honey? What is stronger than the lion? He said to them, if you had not plowed with my heifer. Now, men, let me tell you what this verse means. You don't plow heifers. What he's saying to them is, if you hadn't gone to my wife, he calls his wife a heifer. This is Samson, not me. Calls his wife a heifer. If you had not broken the rules and gone through my wife, that's crossing the line. That's not the rules. If you hadn't broken the rules, you never would have gotten it. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon him, and he went down to Ashkelon and struck down 30 men of the town and took their spoil and gave the garments to those who had told the riddle. In hot anger, he went back to his father's house, and Samson's wife was given to his companion who had been his best man. Now, this is Jerry Springer stuff. He goes down and kills 30 men. The wife he had just married, her dad's going, well, Samson hates my daughter. He doesn't want her anymore. Gives her to his best man. These are the friends of Samson. And he's going off killing people. Here's something I've learned with the struggle of lust. When we have the struggle of lust, and lust is our idol, and I used to just preach this to the men, but now I preach it to women too, because it's just as much an issue with women. When we have this in our lives, we become angry people. Lust and anger go together. Now, you may not go kill 30 people, but you're going to find yourself struggling with anger in different ways when the lust issue is there, because it lights the same fire. It's the same wick in your heart. It's passion that can be godly for righteousness' sake, but it's turned toward the flesh, and it comes out in passion that's sin through anger. And so he's mad because they broke the rules of his little game. Now we get to chapter 15. What do you think chapter 15 is going to be about? Well, it's kind of more of the same stuff. As we get to chapter 15, here's my question for Samson. If Samson had first conquered himself before he sought to conquer everyone else, what a difference his life could have been. The problem is that, and I've said this before, you can choose your sin, you can choose your consequences, but you can't choose both. If I choose to have a six-pack, I've already chosen my actions. I've got to work out every day. If I want the consequences of a ripped body, I don't eat Domino's every night. Or I can choose my actions. I'm going to eat Domino's every night, but the consequences are already set. You can choose your actions, you can choose your consequences, but you can't choose both. And I believe a lot of times, kind of like Shakespeare said in Hamlet, he said, give me that man who is not passion's slave, But Samson's life illustrates the ancient truth that a good beginning does not mean for a good ending. I believe it's kind of what Solomon meant when he said, the end of a matter is better than the beginning. James 1 says this, the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Proverbs 16 says this, he who is a slave to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. Now you're going to see this guy have a lust issue that he does not deal with, he does not repent, he does not submit to the Lord, and then it turns into a woman issue. The title of my message today is A He-Man with a She-Habit. And you're going to see this on and on through the life of Samson. I wonder here at Austin Ridge today how many men I'm talking to that have a sensuality issue that no one else knows about. Internet, reality. I wonder how many women I'm talking to at Austin Ridge today have a sensuality issue. You know, there's a lot of affairs that happen in Austin. An affair takes a woman and a man, right? A lot of women are in affairs. I wonder how many men and women I'm talking to that have eyes for someone else other than their spouse. We were always one dumb mistake away from blowing it, and you are playing with fire. Let's look and see what happens. Verse 9, chapter 15. Actually, I'm going to go back to verse 1. I didn't read these. You guys with me? We're covering a lot today. I apologize. After some days at the time of wheat harvest, Samson went to visit his wife with a young goat. Now, this is the wife he left at the wedding party, went and killed 30 people. She's already been given to his best man, his best man. Samson doesn't even know that yet. He might get a little angry. And he said, I will go to my wife in the chamber. But her father would not allow him to go in. And her father said, I really thought that you utterly hated her. So I gave her to your companion. Spring her alive. Is not her younger sister more beautiful than she? Please take her instead. That's a quality dad right there. And Samson said to them, this time I shall be innocent in regard to the Philistines when I do them harm. So Samson went and caught 300 foxes. That's the animal, not women. 300 foxes and took torches. And he turned them tail to tail and put a torch between each pair of tails. This is crazy. And when he had set fire to the torches, he let the foxes go into the standing grain of the Philistines and set fire to the stack grain and standing grain as well as the olive orchards. Then the Philistines said, who has done this? And they said, Samson, the son-in-law of the Timnite, because he has taken his wife and given her to his companion. And the Philistines came up and burned her and her father with fire. And Samson said to them, if this is what you do, I swear I will be avenged on you. And after that, I will quit. And he struck them hip and thigh with a great blow. And he went down and stayed in the cleft of the rock of Edom. This is the bully at school that he punched me, so you punch him back. He slaps you, so you slap him back. He kicks you, so you kick him back. This is a guy that's just impulsive. If I'm mad, then I'm justified. If I'm lusting, then I'm justified. I just do whatever I want to do. This is a man that has godly parents set aside from the womb to be set apart for the Lord's service. Is it possible for believers to get to the place where they prefer slavery over freedom, where compromise is more comfortable than commitment to the calling of God? You bet it is. And so he goes up in this little area, it's called a cleft of a rock, and then guess who comes after him? The Israelite men. Look at verse 9. Then the Philistines came up and encamped in Judah and made a raid on Lehi. And the men of Judah said, why have you come up against us? They said, we've come up to bind Samson to do to him as he's done to us. Then 3,000 men of Judah. Nowhere in this narrative do they ever get an army together except here, and they get it together to go after one of their own. Who are the enemies in this story? The Philistines. The men of Judah get together, gather their army together to go get Samson to give to the Philistines. Why? Because they had become more comfortable in Philistine culture than Israelite culture. I think Samson could have got a great army together of Israelites, had a great teamwork, a great camaraderie, a great community, have walked with God his entire life, and overthrew the Philistines and never had any of these girls in it. But he didn't have that character to do it. Verse 12, they said to him, "We have come down to bind you," these are the men of Judah, "that we may give you into the hands of the Philistines." And Samson said to them, "Swear to me that you will not attack me yourselves." They said to him, "No, we will only bind you and give you into their hands. We will surely not kill you." So they bound him with two new ropes and brought him up from the rock. When he came to Lehi, the Philistines came shouting to meet him. Then the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon him, and the ropes that were on his arms became as flax that has caught fire, and his bonds melted off his hands. And he found a fresh jawbone of a donkey, and put out his hand and took it, and with it struck 1,000 men. And with the jawbone of a donkey, heaps upon heaps, with the jawbone of a donkey have I struck down 1,000 men. Now, if you grew up like I did in church, and you went to Sunday school, you were taught the Samson story. But now as an adult, when you read this story, you're like, why did they teach us the Samson story? Like, Samson's this hero of the faith, and he's this big strong guy we see in Hebrews. Why would anybody want to be like Samson? He's a murderous, thug-like bully who really doesn't care much about God's holiness, really doesn't care much about accountability, really doesn't listen. He never builds a team. You never see him with good friends. He's a one-man wrecking crew, and the captain of his soul, the master of his fate, is the lust of his flesh. And the only time he ever does anything for the Lord against Philistines is because he's mad at someone. It's not really for the glory of God. It's just because he's upset. He becomes violent. He kills 1,000 men with the jawbone of a donkey. Verse 17, as soon as he had finished speaking, he threw away the jawbone out of his hand, and that place was called Ramoth Lehi. Now, I want to tell you a little bit of what that means. The word Ramoth literally means the hill of the jawbone. It was a place, it was literally a junkyard. It's where you would take your dying or dead animals to leave them. Because as Israelites, you would not have dead animals around. You would take them to this place called Ramoth. It was a junkyard. You leave your dead carcasses there. He picks up a jawbone. He kills 1,000 men. He drops it, and now it's called Ramoth Lehi. In New Testament terms, this same place, you may have heard it called the Hill of the Skull. In Aramaic, it's called Golgotha. In Latin, it's called Calvary. Samson is such a beautiful picture of what Jesus would do to us if you could separate Samson from his flaws. An inconceivable birth from a prophetic voice to a woman who was not able to have a child. This child grows up with the favor of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord comes upon this child. And then one day this child will die at the place of the skull, which is the junkyard heap that we see here in Judges. And just like Samson has to die to save the nation, Jesus will die to save the nation. Every Old Testament character, please get this, every Old Testament character has a flaw, but he points to the New Testament picture of Jesus, who has no flaws. You're supposed to see Jesus in all of these people, and yet none of them are sufficient to save us from our sins. And then Jesus comes along, and he is perfect. Verse 18, he was very thirsty. What one thing have you not seen Samson do yet in this whole dialogue? You haven't heard this man pray at all. He's going to pray now. He was very thirsty. He called upon the Lord. The only time this man prays is when he has a personal need. He says, "You've granted this great salvation by the hand of your servant, and shall I now die of thirst and fall into the hands of the uncircumcised?" What should God do right here with Samson? I mean, should God, this man walks by the word of God, walks by the prophecies, walks by the vows. heaven is sending arrows over his head to warn him constantly, walks by the advice of his parents, walks by any friendships he might have had, does whatever he wants to do. He's violent, he's lustful, he kills men for no reason, and he's praying because he's thirsty. Is there also someone else in the New Testament that you see dying in the same place that says, I am thirsty? Jesus on the cross said the same thing. What did God the Father do with Jesus? He turns his back on the Son. Why? Because my sin was laid upon him and your sin was laid upon him. What is God going to do with Samson here? God should have just, but he doesn't do it. Look what God does. I'm so glad I'm not God. And God split open the hollow place that is at Lehi, and water came out from it. And when he drank, his spirit returned and he revived. Therefore, the name was called something I don't want to try to pronounce. And it is at Lehi to this day. And he judged Israel in the days of the Philistines 20 years. What? If I ever hear someone at Austin Ridge ever say that I don't like the God of the Old Testament, the God of the Old Testament has so much mercy and so much grace and is so long-suffering and is so enduring and his love is so patient. And Samson finally prays. He finally says, I think I'll have a quiet time. You know what the scariest seven words in your Bible are? Here they go. Depart from me, I never knew you. That's the scariest seven words in the Bible. This guy has had no relationship with his father whatsoever. And now he's thirsty, he prays, and God breaks open. Also, what is seen as the junkyard in your Old Testament becomes Calvary in the New Testament. A place of death becomes a place of life. Now, when you get to the end of that, you're thinking, okay, 20 years, there's a little parenthesis there, 20 years, he rules. You're thinking chapter 16, and he repented and everything was good. Look at 16:1. Samson went to Gaza where he saw a prostitute. Now, I'm going to stop there. That's next week. This man's flesh is his God. So I've got just a few minutes, and I want to try to apply this passage for us some more. I believe there's two types of basic churches in America. I believe there's the church that says, you know what, we're going to compromise the word of God and we're going to do whatever it takes to get more people to come to our church because we just care more about numbers than we care about truth. And then there's a type of church that just stands on the truth and says, you know what, it's not about numbers, it's about being faithful, and we're going to be true to the word. We want our church to grow, we're going to go after people, and we believe the truth of the word is what really grows people anyway. Now, each of those two little camps has different variants in it. Sometimes you can get over here where the word becomes the idol, and it's not really about people at all, ever. It's just about how scholarly and theologically deep can we go. And there can be no intimacy at that, but you know your Bible. And then over here, it can be about serving and giving and serving and giving and serving and giving and serving and giving, but it's really not about the authority of Jesus in your life. It's really about just trying to be a good person. And over here in this camp, and I'm just, for convenience sake, I'm just going to call it a more liberal church, okay? There's three main idols that they've accommodated to fit in the culture. Here are the three. Number one, personal choice and freedom. That people's personal choice and freedom is more important than the clear word of God. Number two, absolute tolerance, regardless of what the word of God says. That the greatest sin is to not to tolerate sin in someone else. Number three, the rejection of exclusive truth and personal responsibility. That there's no accountability. If your flesh tells you to do it, do it. If it seems right to you, it must be right. And you can be very spiritual and very churchy in America and still do what your flesh tells you to do. Because you can prove to yourself and justify to yourself that it's okay, just like Samson could. Samson could have said, you know what? I've been like this for 20 years and God's never judged me. Just because God has not brought judgment does not mean he won't. Don't test the patience of God's judgment in your life. I also believe there is a difference between gifts and fruit for the Christian. You may have great gifts, like I may have a gift of communication. And people may come up to me and say, we love your sermons. We really like the way you preach the word of God. You really made an impact in my life. And all that's wonderful. But if I'm not walking with God behind closed doors, what I do in front of you really has little to no impact on my spirituality. I can be the greatest preacher in the world. I believe churches can grow on the communications out of someone's mouth that is having multiple affairs at the same time. I've seen it. Because God is sovereign even in someone else's sin. And God is bigger than one man or one woman. And God can bring goodness out of evilness. So sometimes we start to confuse our gifts with our fruit. Number two, our prayer life rather than religious activities is the greatest indicator of our spiritual health. Our prayer life. How's your prayer life? I'm not talking about attending church. I'm talking about you getting before the Lord and interacting with God. Laying things before him each day. Asking for his wisdom. Asking for his conviction. Not just talking, but listening. See, Samson only prayed as a last resort. And it was always just about him. A lot of times we get prayer requests. I'm not trying to be negative. I'm trying to be insightful. A lot of times the prayer requests, I'd say 95% of the prayer requests we get are about someone who's sick. And I think we should pray for sick people. But praying for people's hearts around us that we love, that their heart would open up to the gospel, that God would use us in that process, that God would raise our kids up to do things only he can pull off, that God would use us in miraculous ways in our cul-de-sacs, at work, in our offices, that we would get close to him and that his holiness would sear our hearts with truth, that we would be more convicted of sin. I would love to see a prayer request that just pray I'd be more convicted because I want more of him. What a great prayer. Tell you another lesson I see here is we've got to avoid this lone ranger Christianity. It was always just sent. He's notable for his aloneness. I think the prescription for focusing on outward impressiveness while suffering with interior destruction is what was happening in Samson's life. And no one's close enough to call him out on it. It's easy to stay hidden with sin when you don't have any friends that you let close. And you're going to see 20 years this sin, this seeds are sitting for 20 years, and it comes out in chapter 16. I heard one pastor say this. I thought it was very good. He said, most Christians sow their wild oats and spend the rest of their lives praying for crop failure. Let me read that again because that should have gotten a response from you. Most Christians sow their wild oats and spend the rest of their lives praying for crop failure. Lord, I know I'm sinning, I know I'm rebelling, and I'm just hoping that nothing happens from it. But the Bible says it like this, do not be deceived, for God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he shall also reap. 20 years later, you're going to pick up on chapter 16 next week. So in here today at Austin Ridge, how many of us are living a dual life? It's a whole lot easier to be instructed by parents or friends or a pastor than pain. Is it possible for a person to walk by the Bible, by parents, by problems, by pain, by mercies, and just get harder toward the Lord? You bet it is. Has the externals been there in your life, but you are rotting from the inside, and no one knows? My friend, I am not coming to you to condemn you or to make you feel worse. I am simply telling you that your sin will find you out. One day we're going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and everything we've done and said is going to be seen by all. That should cause a reverential fear of God. That what we do every day matters. I've got a list of guys that I keep in my wallet of men that have poured into my life spiritually, who have made an impact in my life spiritually, and who have fallen spiritually. The guy who made the greatest impact in my life, his name was Chris, back in college, served 10 years in jail for molesting children. I've got a list. I'm old enough now to have a list of friends who have fallen. If you start to think that it won't happen to you, you are ripe. And you may be sitting here today thinking, I've got it hidden and everything's okay. I'm telling you, it's not. Your marriage is worse for it. Your parenting is worse for it. The job you do at work is worse for it. But more than all of that, God knows. Would you just tell somebody what's going on in your life and let us help? I tell you, when people come to me and they share their sin struggles with me, they're thinking, man, he'll never respect me. He'll never want me at his church. He'll never look at me the same. It's the opposite. It makes me feel closer to people. It makes me say, you know, that guy cares about his walk with the Lord. That woman cares about what God knows to be true. And here's the truth. Some of you may come at Austin Ridge and thinking, man, it's tough to come here because everyone here is just perfect. They all love Jesus. They're all perfect. Their lives are perfect. It's a farce, I'm telling you. The folks you're looking at in this room thinking they're perfect, they're jacked up just like you. Some of us hide it better. But we are a needy, broken, sinful, left to ourselves, self-destructing people at Austin Ridge. And apart from the grace of God and his mercy and the authority of his word, we are all undone. And if you're sitting here thinking you're not in that category, you, my friend, are mistaken. I realize every day I could do something stupid to break the testimony of 46 years of trying to walk with Jesus in one moment. And I beg the grace of God every day to protect me in those things. And you should too. Father, we thank you for today. I thank you for the lessons to learn from a bad example. And I pray that we would never be a newspaper article in someone else's wallet or on someone else's refrigerator. We would never be an email chain of, did you hear about, did you find out, did you know? Lord, I pray that when the covers are pulled back from our lives, the same thing that's seen outside the covers are seen inside the covers. And Lord, we're not perfect, and that doesn't mean we will ever be perfect. What it does mean is we strive to be more like you. We want you. We want to be intimate with you. Whether heaven and hell is real or not, we just want you. Because life is better with you than without you. I pray for my friends at Austin Ridge that may be struggling spiritually. Maybe there's a hidden sin. Maybe they're not even willing to say it's a sin. Or maybe they don't even care if it's a sin. They're still bowed up on it. I pray that you break their hearts open. I pray your mercy and grace would pour in and that they would believe what the scriptures say, that confess your sins one to another for healing takes place. It's in the glorious name of Jesus we pray. Amen.